People ask how a sculptor of monumental scale, figurative statuary makes the sculptural forms that enchant and inspire viewers. Marshall Fredericks, one of the most prolific traditional figurative sculptors of the 20th century, had a simple explanation. He said, "It's magic." Like most magic, the process of making monumental figurative sculpture can be explained. Let's look at Frederick's last great work, The Poet, Lord Byron. Frederick's first conceived the sculpture while teaching at the Cranbrook Educational Community in Bloomfield Hills, Michigan during the 1930s. By 1938, he produced a small version of Lord Byron, and a half century later began work on the larger-than-life or heroic scale sculpture. While concurrently creating several other works during the last decade of his life, Frederick's modeled in clay the dramatic composition of Lord Byron, the popular British poet of the 19th century Romantic period and a favorite author of Frederick's. The sculptor built up the forms in soft, malleable clay that he applied to a wooden armature or skeleton. The forms, lines, and surface textures were all worked into the clay by the sculptor's hands and a few simple tools. Fredericks often said that modeling was a long process of building up the forms and raking them down until the shapes and textures were just right. A few days before his death on April 4, 1998, the artist declared the 11-foot-3-inch tall poet complete. Over the following year, his assistant of 17 years, Scott Slocum, began the time-consuming task of transforming the original clay model into a plaster likeness that would later be cast in bronze. Slocum worked with metal shims to outline where the piece molds would separate. After coating the clay model with plaster, he then carefully removed the plaster molds from the clay original. The plaster piece molds were then used to cast a plaster model, an exact plaster replica of Frederick's original clay model. The plaster model then went to the Beattie Mackey Foundry in Brooklyn, New York. There, foundrymen who had cast many of Frederick's sculptures during his long and productive career made new, temporary molds using green sand for casting the bronze. The sand was packed hard around the plaster model sections. Sprues, gates, and risers were formed into the sand to provide conduits for the molten bronze and vents for the gases to escape. Once cast, each section was finished with chisels and grinders to remove the gates and risers. This part of the foundry work is known as cold working, or chasing. The bronze castings were then fitted together and welded. With additional chasing to disguise the joints and integrate the several sections into a single monumental form. Next, the foundry colored the bronze by applying liver of sulfur to provide a base coat for the semi-transparent sea green patina Frederick's favorite throughout his life. Heat was applied to accelerate the chemical changes caused by brushing on liquid cupric nitrate. The patina was built up in several thin layers, not as a paint with pigments applied to the bronze, but with successive chemical alterations to the bronze, which caused its color to change the way a bright copper penny discolors over time through contact with oils in human hands or moisture from the environment. Finally, a light coat of wax was applied to protect the bronze from moisture and pollutants that might prematurely corrode the bronze with stains, streaks, and discoloration. The sculpture was then shipped to Michigan to join hundreds of other bronze sculptures, plaster models, and related art at the Marshall Frederick Sculpture Museum at Saginaw Valley State University. Like many sculptors who made monumental statuary during the middle and end of the 20th century, Frederick's usually made plaster models to serve as the patterns for his large bronzes. To make the plaster models, Frederick's first had to make a plaster mold of the clay original. In fact, the plaster mold is made in multiple pieces so that the molds will separate from the original model. Frederick's often used a small plaster model to determine the dividing or parting lines for the piece molds. Once the parting lines are determined, brass shims are inserted into the clay along the lines. These shims will enable the plaster mold sections to separate. Some shims are bent or crimped to form keys or darts that will facilitate accurate reassembly of the mold sections. Tiny brass pieces are bent around the shims to hold them together. Once the shims are in place to define the edges of the plaster piece molds, the actual mold making can begin. Water is added to a clean mixing bowl. Laundry bluing is used to tint the initial plaster batch so it will appear different than the white plaster layers to follow. This will facilitate removal of the plaster piece molds from the plaster model much later in the process. Dry plaster powder is sifted into the tinted water to ensure that no clumps will occur. The soupy mix is used to be sure the plaster makes good contact with the clay model. The plaster is often thrown onto the clay to force it into nooks and crannies and to help drive out air bubbles that might get trapped on the surface of the clay. Those bubbles would create bumps in the plaster model made from the mold. Sometimes a syringe is used to project the plaster into undercut areas. Once the first layer of wet plaster dries sufficiently to hold its shape, more plaster is mixed with water and applied in a second coat. The process may be repeated a third or fourth time. As the mold thickens, the layers can be coarser and thicker. These take longer to dry, perhaps overnight. Once the mold is thick enough to retain its shape on the model, reinforcement is added to ensure the mold does not warp or break when it is removed from the clay. Frederick's often used aluminum conduit because it was strong, lightweight, and relatively easy to cut and bend to the proper shape. Plus, it makes strong handles for the heavy plaster molds. Reinforcement is generally attached to the mold with more wet plaster. As the process continues, special attention must be paid to where one piece mold attaches to another. For instance, the top of the mold around the torso was grooved with a special tool to create a key for matching that mold section with the mold section that will be cast adjacent to it. A coat of shellac will ensure its eventual release. Also, the unique shapes of the various parts of the model require unique solutions to those challenges. A case in point is the poet's right jaw. It was necessary to pour a separate piece mold between the shims and the face. Again, it was keyed and shellacked to ensure a proper release from the adjacent mold. After all the details are tended to, the final piece molds can be cast. Before the individual molds can be released from the model, plaster covering the edges of the shims must be scraped down. As the molds are removed from the clay model, the magic is revealed, an exact replica in reverse of every detail of the form and texture of the clay model. After the plaster mold sections are removed from the clay model, any clay that sticks to the molds is carefully removed. The plaster piece molds are usually reassembled and clamped together so that they do not warp over the days or weeks it takes to produce all of the piece molds. The complete plaster model for a monumental scale sculpture is usually made in sections to facilitate fabrication of the model and the subsequent bronze casting. The practical method of casting the poet is to make the base, the right arm, and the head and shoulders as separate units. The upper and lower torsos of the figure are also made as separate units. To make these sections, the plaster piece molds are disassembled and prepared to accept the wet plaster of the model. Each mold is brushed with a parting agent made from stearic acid, mineral oil, and kerosene. This parting agent will help prevent the wet plaster from sticking to the piece mold. Dry, powdered plaster is then mixed with water and applied to the mold surface. Once dry, additional layers of wet plaster are added, just as they were in making the piece molds. Large mold sections, such as these, need reinforcement for strength. One common practice is to wet burlap cloth, saturate it with plaster, and apply it in layers until the desired thickness is achieved. Once dry, the individual model sections can be attached using the same methods and materials. This entire process is repeated with each of the piece molds. When the model sections dry, the plaster molds can be removed. This usually involves the destruction of the molds themselves. They become waste material, hence the name waste molds. As the mold maker chisels deeper, the blue layer of plaster appears. With the hands of a surgeon, the final pieces of mold are removed, and the plaster model is revealed. After the plaster model sections are finished, they are assembled to ensure that they fit together snugly. finally, weeks after starting the plaster mold and model making, the full plaster model is complete and ready for shipment to the bronze foundry. Making the sand molds takes place here at the Beattie Mackey Art Foundry in Brooklyn, New York. Sand molds are the most economical and practical way to make large-scale bronze castings. Large, simple sculptural forms are created more easily using sand molds than using the ancient lost wax process. And a large sculpture can usually be cast in fewer sections, which improves the quality of the sculpture and reduces labor costs of joining. Each section of the sculpture requires both an outer mold and an inner mold, or core. This is because bronze castings are hollow. The bronze is actually a thin shell, about 1/4 inch thick. Sand molds are made inside two rectangular iron flasks, the cope on top and the drag below. The drag is partially filled with a moist, coarse backing sand and wood scraps to form a temporary holding bed for the plaster model. The sand is rammed hard against the model, and a parting line is formed where the top and bottom mold sections will separate. The molder makes a series of piece molds on top of the model using a moist, fine-grained sand called French sand. French sand holds its shape once packed. Consequently, it fits into tiny recesses, and it replicates forms and textures accurately. Each piece mold is tapered so that it will draw away easily from the model and adjacent pieces when the plaster model is removed and the molds refitted. To ensure that all of the piece molds will separate, a parting agent, talcum powder, is pounced or dusted over the surface. Nails mark spots for the gates and risers, inlets for the molten bronze, and outlets for the hot gases. After the top half of the outer mold is covered with a layer of French sand, the cope is fitted on top of the drag and clamped to it. Metal rods are bent to shape and added to reinforce the mold. The cope is then rammed full of coarse sand. Wooden dowels are positioned and wired together. After the sand is leveled, these are removed, making the gates and risers. The cope and drag are then inverted, and the temporary bed of sand and wood is removed from the drag. The drag is then fitted back into place, and the sand packing process is repeated to complete the bottom half of the outer mold. Once that half is finished, the drag is lifted off. The exposed sections of the piece molds left against the model are then carefully removed and reassembled in their corresponding positions in the drag. Once the piece molds are repositioned, the plaster model can be removed and the outer mold is complete.
1, 2, and 3, yes.
The hard-packed sand molds mirror perfectly the textures and forms of the original plaster model. These molds will determine the outer surface of the bronze casting.
Thank you very much.
Now, the core of the mold must be made. The core must fit in the cavity of the outer mold with just a 1/4 inch clearance all around for the bronze. To make the core for the bust of the poet, a metal armature is shaped inside the hollow mold. Parts of the armature extend into the outer mold to hold the core firmly in place. The armature is removed, and a thin layer of sand is then added to the cavity and rammed. The armature is then reinserted. Sand is built up to duplicate as nearly as possible the mold in the drag. Small clumps of sand are added to the surface to help determine the shape of the core. By fitting the cope on the drag and then lifting it off, the molder can see where the two surfaces touched and add or remove sand where needed. Once the core conforms to the mold in the drag, the sand is compressed. Again, small mounds of sand are placed on the core and the cope and drag are fitted together to check the thin gap between the core and the outer mold. This gap of about 1/4 inch will be filled with bronze. Both the core and outer mold are painted with a mixture of graphite and water to consolidate the surface and harden the sand. All surfaces are then heated with a torch or skin dried to remove moisture. The cope and drag containing the core are then heated in a kiln overnight until the sand is rock hard and dry throughout. To utilize manpower and time, foundrymen work on multiple molds at the same time. Here, the mold for the legs is removed from the kiln and prepared for the pour. The core is then removed from the drag, carefully inspected, and touched up if necessary. Piece molds are placed back in their original positions and tacked in place. A funnel or sprue made of refractory cement is positioned on top of the cope to channel the molten bronze into the main gate of the mold. The mold, with the core suspended inside, is reassembled for the last time and sealed with a goopy mixture of oil and carving powder. This prevents the molten bronze from flashing between the mold sections. Then paper plugs are fitted into the risers to keep sand from falling inside the mold. Foundrymen then form the sand to retain the molten bronze that will overflow when the mold is filled. Finally, after days of painstaking efforts, the outer mold with its core in place is ready for the bronze pour. The day before the pour, the empty sand molds are pushed into the kiln to heat overnight. This will reduce the initial shock as the molten metal enters the hot mold. As the crucible heats up, bronze ingots are gently added a few at a time until the hundreds of pounds of bronze are molten metal. The glowing crucible full of red-hot molten bronze is removed from the furnace where it has been heated to 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit. It takes many hours to melt the metal, but only moments to pour. Foundrymen quickly scrape the dross or impurities off the top of the bronze and pour the metal at its optimum temperature and fluidity.
Oh.
Several molds are usually poured at once. Metal molds are used to hold any excess bronze not needed for the sculptures because the molten bronze cannot be allowed to solidify in the crucible. These bronze ingots can be remelted and used later. In only a few minutes, the bronze casting cools and solidifies. Then the sand mold is removed to reveal the bronze replica of the original plaster model. The bronze is now ready for cold working, where its gates and risers will be ground off and all traces of the casting process will disappear. The cutting, grinding, and finishing of the bronze sculpture is called chasing or cold working. The first step in cold working the bronze is to remove the sprues and gates. They are sawn off, leaving short plugs attached to the bronze sculpture. These are ground down and the textures are applied to match the surrounding area. Then the separately cast bronze sections are assembled. Earlier in the 20th century, bronze sections were fitted together and pinned, an attachment known as a Roman joint because it was used by the ancient Romans. Today, welding is the most common joining method. All joints must be cold worked or chased to blend them into the surrounding surfaces so that the joins are not detectable in the finished bronze. Once chasing or cold working is complete, the bronze is patinated. Patination is the chemical process of coloring bronze. Bronzes are not painted. Instead, chemicals are applied to cause the bronze to change color, much like a copper penny changes color over time from contact with the oils and salts on human hands. Usually, bronzes are heated with a torch in preparation for patination. Heat is a catalyst that accelerates chemical reactions. Patinas are built up in successive steps. To get the semi-transparent sea green patinas Fredericks favored throughout his career, a base coat of ammonium sulfide, or liver of sulfur, is applied first to dull the bright tones of the raw bronze for conversion to the sea green color. Then, copper nitrate is brushed on the hot bronze, causing the dark brown bronze to change to sea green. The sea green patina is thickened and deepened through successive applications of copper nitrate. Finally, the patinated bronze is waxed to protect it from deterioration caused by water, dirt, and pollution. The wax gives the bronze a glossy, glistening surface that beads water and facilitates periodic cleaning and buffing.